Good afternoon and welcome to this session on the second day of our second face-to-face interaction. Today, I wish to discuss a few important aspects, in fact, two of them, both very critical. Frankly, the task I shall be doing today is not a very pleasant task. You will soon know why. First, I would like to comment on the presence of participants in the face-to-face interaction. These sessions that we have arranged on three weekends permit two things. One is face-to-face interaction amongst the participants at a remote center. And second, it permits interaction between all participants and IIT faculty. So as you know, if you ask a question and it is answered from here, it is the person who is asking the question, the person who is responding is seen by all participants across RCs. Now, what is in the minds of people is that these interactive sessions are primarily planned to permit such interaction between you and the faculty at IIT Bombay. While it is one of the objectives, it is not the main objective. The main objective is to permit activities and interaction at the RC, which is the main purpose, which means that when you participate as a group of 20, 30, 40, 50 faculty members in an RC, there is a lot of discussion that happens within the participants. The afternoon labs are done often collectively. Now onwards, as you know, we are forming teams and many of the activities will be based on teams. And it's not just a team of three or four people working in isolation. We would expect discussions amongst teams, amongst all the participants. That is where the knowledge that we gain gets consolidated. We can raise some common doubts. These could be communicated to IIT Bombay or put on the discussion forum, and all of us will become wiser through such discussions and interaction. That is the reason why we had said right up front that participation in this critical part is mandatory. Now, it is possible that for some genuine reason, someone may not be able to attend either a session or half a session. First of all, this should be avoided. The reason must be very serious for your not being able to participate. And even in such case, when you are not able to participate in this critical part because of some genuine reason, one, you must inform the workshop coordinator at your remote center and inform the IIT Bombay team of your absence. More important than that, if for some genuine reason you are absent, it is your responsibility to make up for your absence. How do you make up for your absence? Immediately find out from the workshop coordinator and from other colleagues what exactly transpired. If there was an activity which was required to be completed during the face-to-face interaction sessions, such as in the labs in the afternoon, you are expected to complete them either individually or with the help of remote center coordinator, workshop coordinator. But you must complete those activities because that is part and parcel of this FDP. So I hope I am very clear. Nobody is supposed to miss these interactions. It is not adequate that you come, sign your presence in the morning and then disappear for the session. That is in fact worse, because what is expected of you is that you participate and contribute to the discussions that happen within the participants group assembled at any RC and participate similarly in the lab session. So I hope I am very clear on this, and I hope that if there has been any absence because of some genuine reasons, if previously the matter has not been reported, we do get some emails saying that someone is not able to attend this date or that date. We presume that the person is taking care of making up for the absence by interacting with the workshop coordinator and other team members. If you have not done so far, please start doing it in case you miss this or the next session. The second matter is more serious and unfortunately far more unpleasing. This relates to assignment submissions. As you know, there are multiple individual assignments were required to be submitted in the first 4 weeks. These were peer assessed, individually submitted. There are several individual online quizzes which were expected to be done. In coming weeks, you will be doing team assignments as well as individual assignments. For example, today Professor Sundar has given an assignment. Part of that is a team assignment which you will work during the lab sessions today. I believe that the team leader of every team is supposed to submit some kind of a paper design by scanning 2, 3, 4 pages that your team prepares and then uploading that as a team assignment. That is more for a record. Of course, each member of the team should carry these 3 or 4 pages paper design and subsequently work individually to prepare a simple website as he has directed. That will be peer assessed later after the assignment submission. Now, when I am doing such assignment submissions either individually as a member of the team, I have also agreed that all these assignments, including for example the course material and other lectures recorded interaction, etc. You remember we have said that we will release all of this in open source. You have all agreed for that. And the objective is that the combined learning by all of us is actually made available to a much wider body of colleague teachers across the country and perhaps elsewhere in the world. This is all good intentions. But let us see, unfortunately, what has happened. Before I tell you what has actually happened in this FDP, I would like to comment on a key word called plagiarism. I hope all of you have heard about this word. If not, please understand the exact meaning of this. When a piece of work done by one person is copied by another person and submitted by the second person as his or her own work without clearly acknowledging the original author is termed as plagiarism. In common parlance, we call this copying. There are multiple instances when such copying can happen. For example, students copying answers in an examination, or students copying either a complete assignment or a part of an assignment when they are required to submit it as a part of the course or subject that we teach. Amongst grown-ups, unfortunately, such copying happens when some part of the research work done by a colleague, either now or earlier, is copied and verbatim reproduced, but it is reproduced as my work. Now, when I do this, it is actually copying of a research paper, part of research paper, copying of a thesis. All of this are examples of plagiarism. Needless to say, such plagiarism is simply not accepted. Why the temptation occurs to plagiarize? So let me put my points. All of you are aware of these. Number one, I am a student or I am a participant in a workshop like this. I do not have time to do the work on my own, but I need to submit something within a deadline. So I may be tempted that I don't have time, but some friend of mine has done something. Okay, since there are 4,000 people submitting assignments, maybe it will pass. I will just copy his or her assignment and submit as my own. The other reason could be I am unable to do the work myself because perhaps I have not prepared, I have not studied properly, but I have a compulsion to submit because either marks are involved if I am a student or a certificate is involved if I am a teacher. In our case, surely a certificate recognized by AICT is involved, and that could tempt me if either I am inadequately prepared or I do not have time. I might think, chalo, I will just take somebody's submission, copy it and submit it. When I do so, I do it in the belief that, one, my act will not be caught. Or no, obviously, that if my act is caught, there could be some penalty, but I presume, I believe that this act may not be caught. The second, even if there is some risk of being caught, I assess that risk and I say, all right, there are 4,000 people in this FDP, they are submitting, even if they catch. So what could be the penalty? Perhaps likely to be no penalty, or perhaps likely to be a minimal penalty. I consciously decide that I am willing to take that risk. And the moment my mind accepts that risk, I become prey to the temptation. Now I am tempted to copy something, submit it as my own. The first time it happens, it is not caught. I am not penalized, I am tempted to do it the second time. This is actually part of a generic value system that crumbles if efforts are not made to curb such temptation. I am not blaming anyone. This is a human nature. All of us are great optimizers. All of us as human beings would like to try to minimize our efforts and maximize our gains. And such temptations occur for marks among students, for recognition or certifications amongst faculty, for money amongst people who are grown up, and that is what we call corruption in fact, or for fame, for whatever reason. In fact, the entire societal value system actually attempts to promote understanding that such things are bad and such things should not be done. That is the reason why we have legal system, justice, punishment, etc., etc. That is because whatever we dub as bad should not happen. If someone does a bad thing, there must be at least a rap on the knuckle or a severe penalty depending upon the act and the severity of the act. Now, this I speak generically, but let me come back to the academic values, which is what concerns us most at this juncture. First and foremost, all of us should understand one thing about digital submissions, which is what is happening in this FDP and which is what will happen increasingly in coming years and decades, not only for FDPs, but even for teaching that we normally do. Those of you who teach in an environment with reasonable computerized facilities available, such as programming assignments, for example, in IIT Bombay, they are all submitted online. Now, whenever you submit anything online in a digital form, the first and foremost thing that I must understand that if I made a submission, that submission remains as a record. It cannot be refuted. What it means is, if I have submitted something, whatever it is, my own or anybody else's, copied, whatever, if I have submitted something, when it was submitted, who submitted it, and what was submitted, all of this remains as a record in a server, generally far removed from myself. So, whenever I submit, I must understand this, that it is not for now. Even 1 year later, 10 years later, that submission can be examined and it can be established who submitted it, when it was submitted and what exactly was submitted. That cannot be refuted. More importantly, if such submissions contain text, then the text can be auto-analyzed. Auto-analyzed means what? I do not know whether you have heard of a software called Turnitin. Turnitin is actually a repository of an extremely large number of research papers. So, I will tell you how we use this Turnitin. It helps us to find out if a new research paper that comes to me contains any paragraphs or similarity with any one of the previously published lakhs of research papers. You know how we use it? Sometimes our MTech students or PhD students, when they submit their internal reports, let us say literature survey. Now, a literature survey is by definition a survey of what others have done, but there our instructions are crystal clear. If you survey somebody else's paper, then number one, you must acknowledge that person, you must cite that person's name and research in the literature survey part, and number two, you are required to rephrase the wordings used by that researcher in his or her publication. You are not permitted to reproduce it verbatim. If you do that, you have to put it in double quotes as a quotation. Many research scholars, many MTech students are often tempted to either omit the reference, pose somebody else's work as one's own work. So, what we do is, every time we get a submission, we actually pass it through this Turnitin software. And this Turnitin very nicely gives me the percentage of the material in this paper, which appears to be common with this paper or that paper or that paper. What it means is that if my student has been tempted to copy from somebody else's paper, 99% I will be able to discover it at the first attempt when I see that, and therefore I can clobber it. I can shout at my research scholar or MTech student, tell him this nonsense must stop, make that person rewrite it and resubmit. This is the normal use of Turnitin. Please note that when such material which has been copied but without acknowledgement is put in public domain. And remember, a submission to a research conference is a public domain submission. A submission such as you make for this FDP is incidentally also a public domain submission, because you are submitting it to a common site which is committed. IIT Bombay is committed, as you all know, to collect all of this and put it in open source for public good, which means that if such plagiarized material is put in public domain, it may cause very serious damage to the reputation of both the individual and to the institution the individual belongs to. So, suppose I am a teacher in one of the colleges and I am tempted to plagiarize something and submit that assignment, then if that act is caught, I will be put to shame, my institute will be put to shame, and additionally and unfortunately, IIT Bombay will be put to shame, because IIT Bombay permitted such material to be released in open source. All of this, you would agree, must be avoided. Now, I come to the main point. The penalty of that the academic community imposes on such plagiarism whenever it is detected could be very severe, because this is considered a very serious matter globally. We often talk of developed countries and developing countries. We often have a wrong impression that developed country means a rich country, developing country means a poor country. While that may be so, the poverty is not merely in terms of money and riches. The poverty is also in terms of discipline, both self-discipline and social discipline. The matter of plagiarism is taken extremely seriously in all developed countries. And in fact, it is taken very seriously globally, particularly in academics. So, in case of students, this may result in a fail grade or even expulsion. This happens in IIT Bombay. I mean, I have been teaching for 45 years. I always announce that even if you get less marks, it's okay. But if you copy anything, you'll get a fail grade immediately in the course, and the matter will be reported to the institute authorities. There are cases where the institute authorities have decided to expel such students, just to ensure that the rigor of the academic values is maintained. Such is the case that is followed everywhere practically in global academics, certainly also in India. After all, US teachers, when you supervise examinations and when you note that some students have copied, don't you take similar action? You do. Sadly, if it happens with teachers, what should be done? Obviously, a very serious action must be taken by the concerned authorities. Now, when detected, a penalty is always imposed, is the underlying fact. I would like all colleague teachers to know it. We do it for our students, we must do it for ourselves as well if such a thing happens. Sorry for this lengthy background, but let me come to the point now. A very sad point. In my life of conducting so many FDPs, copying of assignments in this FDP has happened. Several cases have been detected and established. Now, as I speak, more auto analysis is happening. That means, very shortly, for all the submissions that have been already made and the submissions that will be made in future, we apply the same thing. We will do a detailed analysis, both manual and automatic, to determine if there is any copying case. Please remember that such occurrences are simply unacceptable. In fact, I will go one step forward and I will say that even helping someone do this is wrong. Suppose a friend comes to me and I say, he tells me, hey, Baba, I am not able to understand this. Will you please give me your assignment so that I will upload it as mine? And because he is my friend, I say, okay, go ahead and do that. That is wrong. In fact, it is worse. Please remember, if I give my assignment to a friend, I am not acting as his or her friend. I am actually acting as his or her enemy. I am jeopardizing his or her chances of learning, number one, and I am putting him or her at great risk, because if the matter is caught, the person would be deeply penalized. And some of that mud will stick to my clothes as well, because I am the person who has helped. So, please remember, we all must collectively ensure that such nonsense does not happen at all. As far as the normal penalty is concerned for such copying when it happens in the case of an FDP, for example. Going by the same norms that we apply to the students, these are the norms that we have decided. These norms are, number one, in every such case where it is detected, and please remember, it is not a question of one assignment or two assignments or all assignments. Copying is a copying is a copying. Theft is a theft is a theft. If that happens, then the penalty ordinarily would be, number one, certificate of FDP completion is denied. Even if a certificate is issued and the case is detected later, such certification can be revoked. Obvious penalty, like giving a fail grade to a student. Report the names to the authorities. Which are the authorities? In this particular case, the authorities governing you is not IIT Bombay. We will of course report it to IIT Bombay as a matter of reporting, but the matter will be reported to the institution in which you serve and to AICT. Second, at the third and most important thing, what we have decided is we will display the list of such people publicly on NMEICT website. Please remember that we have to ensure that number one, such acts do not happen, and number two, if such acts happen, then an appropriate penalty is imposed. Well, many of you might be considering, even those who have not indulged in any plagiarism may be considering that this penalty is too harsh. And I admit, this penalty is too harsh, but this is the penalty that we have been giving to our students for decades. And there is no reason to assume that a similar penalty should not be imposed for the very, very mean act of falling prey to the temptation of copying and submitting something as my own assignment. This is a criminal activity academically, and this must be penalized. But since this might be the first occasion when colleague teachers are tempted to do this, after all, it is not very often that we teachers have to submit assignments. Is only when we attend FDPs, particularly hard FDPs such as this, where a lot of work is required to be done and all of us are compelled by circumstances to spend our time in several other things, including our duties, our family commitment. So it is quite possible that I did not get enough time or I could not prepare much, and assuming that the risk is not much, I was tempted to do this probably for the first time. Since such a possibility exists, my colleagues have advised me to permit one opportunity which will result in a softer penalty. Let me describe the process that I have decided to follow. This is the alternative. This alternative will provide an opportunity to all participants. If a participant has been tempted to copy and submit, then the participant will get a chance to admit if one has given in to such temptation. Every such admission must result in complete details being given, which assignment was copied, when, from whom. Further, the participant must commit not to do so ever again, because after all, we are all trying to establish academic values. And redo and submit the plagiarized submission. That means, suppose I was tempted to copy two assignments in the past, I must redo those assignments now truly on my own and submit them. Of course, I will not get any marks or credits for those assignments. Let me tell you, this is truly a soft alternative. For example, if I have copied, let's say, two out of three assignments, I am required to resubmit them after admitting that I have copied. When I resubmit those two assignments, I still don't get any marks. Do I lose the opportunity to get a certificate because possibly I have done enough hard work for remaining FDP? You will notice that the grading policy that has been announced allocates only a smaller percentage of marks for the submission of your assignment. All right, if I have copied two assignments by falling into temptation, then I will lose submission marks for those two assignments. But there are enough activities that have happened in the past, and there will be enough activities going forward which will permit me to get a minimum score in this FDP so that I am able to get a proper certificate of completion. So all is not lost. I still have a chance. and I get an opportunity to correct myself. Of course, how do we implement this, for example? So there is one more point which I have not written here, but which is uppermost in my mind. See, for example, even when my students are concerned, and there have been occasions in the past where I have given them similar opportunity, I do not want them to publicly confess. In fact, if someone has fallen into temptation, one is already feeling sad about it, and one would feel very humbled if it becomes known publicly that I have done this copy. So what I do is, I say, look, you admit, but you admit to me only, not to anyone else, and I promise not to divulge your name to anyone else, because your self-esteem is important to me. I am also a human, you are also a human. I have therefore decided that this alternative shall be implemented through an obligatory survey for all participants. So we will be putting up this obligatory survey or obligatory feedback exercise. Every participant, all participants, all 4000 participants who have registered and enrolled and who have made any submission so far, whether they are continuing to engage with this FDP further or not, it does not matter. Even a single submission made, and suppose I did not find time, I was involved in some other activities and I had to give up attending subsequent sessions of this FDP, still one submission that I have made, I am accountable for that submission, and therefore I must fill up this obligatory feedback exercise. This will be set up on the Moodle, where every participant must A, say that, look, I have not copied any assignment, period, I state so, my survey ends. 2, if I have been tempted to copy any assignment, then I will give all the details. This will not be an anonymous survey, because I must know who is saying what. However, normally, as you know, Moodle surveys are visible to many people. Number one, the first thing visible is how many people have submitted. That is the reason why I am making it obligatory for everyone to submit. Because suppose there are, I was tempted to copy and there were exactly 100 people like me, then those 100 people will only submit, their names will be visible and everybody will know, array, these 100 jokers have copied something. Now that will reduce my self-esteem. We do not want that to happen. Therefore, this survey shall be obligatory for everyone. That means if there are 4000 or 3500 or whatever number of actual enrolled participants, each one must submit. So obviously, anybody looking at that survey will only see so many people have submitted, all of them of course must submit. What they have submitted, however, will not be visible. Now here is a trick. Moodle normally permits teachers, teaching assistants, non-editing teachers to look at the entire analysis, and that means to look at every individual submission. This also is bad. Suppose, for example, I was tempted to copy something. I am in some remote center X where I am participating. Now, as you all, as I just mentioned, I would not like people to know that I have done this. But if I submit this survey, and if my workshop coordinator was to read it, if 10 other faculty members in IIT Bombay or teaching assistants everywhere was to read it, I will lose my self-esteem. So we are setting up a mechanism such that this feedback survey submissions will not be visible, will not be visible to non-editing teachers, will not be visible to workshop coordinators. These survey results will be visible only to a small group of senior faculty at IIT Bombay, and I will take personal responsibility for it. Second, we will never make public the detailed submissions that are given by individuals. That is my personal promise. This is because, as I said earlier, I value the self-esteem of every individual and certainly that of a colleague teacher. But given this guarantee, it is very, very important that every faculty member participating in this FDP does complete this obligatory feedback exercise and exonerates oneself if one has been tempted, or states very proudly that, look, I have never done this and I don't need to do it. Please help me to collectively establish strong academic values. This is something which is very, very important. I will conclude by saying that we as teachers are not only responsible to teach subjects to our students, that of course we do. We also know that students are clever enough to learn these subjects on their own often. However, our main job is to motivate them, to help them try to get enthusiastic about learning something, and a still more important job, to pass on the right value systems to the youth of the country. That is our job. Please note that our students, whether you like it or not, our students hold us in some high esteem. In fact, they actually try to see role models in us. Our behavior is taken by them as if it's a model behavior. If it comes to be known that we ourselves are so weak in our values, do you think our students will learn better values? On the other hand, if our students are convinced that we are committed to establish and follow good value system, then perhaps there is a chance that many students, if not all, will follow that value system and say, yes, that's the right way to do it. Once again, I apologize for taking a lot of your time in this important part of face-to-face interaction, where we have a whole lot of very important and useful things to do. But I felt that this was extremely critical. I felt that I should not act one way only by imposing the penalties that are normally to be done, and that I must offer an alternative for those colleagues who have unfortunately fallen prey to such temptations, perhaps for the first time in this FD. So, I will just repeat this. This survey will be put up 2 to 3 days later. There will be a time period of about 4 to 5 days in which you have to submit the survey. But please remember that those of you who have been tempted to copy, start assembling quietly within yourself all the records, which assignment you had copied when you submitted that and from whom you had copied. You will be required to give that. Those of us who have not indulged in such unfortunate practice, of course, just have to say, look, I have not done this, and that would be the end of the matter. I repeat again, if this is done, we will not impose the normal penalty. Such participants are most welcome to continue to benefit from this FDP. They will even be given a certificate of completion if they score the minimum required marks or grades in the remaining part of the course, and of course in the other assignments which they have not copied. And there is a very good chance, because a large amount of such assessment is yet to be done. I will conclude by saying, please enjoy this FDP, notwithstanding whatever I have said, but please do reflect upon what I have said. Please do discuss among your own groups. If you have any suggestions to make, any observations to make, please make them in a generic way, not naming any person, not showing any disrespect for any individual, because we are all colleagues. But if you have any general opinions, if you have any general observations, please do make them, because collectively our wisdom should prevail on all of us, and later on all the lakhs of teachers, to establish and nurture great academic values. I would like you to get over this shock. I am still reeling under this shock. I have not got over this, because frankly, I never in my life expected that colleague teachers from other institutions would be tempted to do such thing. I will come out of the shock, but I hope you agree that this is the only way forward. We have no choice. People who are caught but do not admit for making that mistake will have to be penalized. The penalty that I have outlined will be explicitly followed. We will report the name of such people to the authorities, namely their own institution and to AICT, and we'll publicize that list. That is the minimum that must happen. Of course, such people will not be given completion certificate. However, I request you earnestly to consider the alternative. This alternative is sadly not only for those people who are tempted to do such a mistake, but is obligatory for everyone. And why it is obligatory for everyone? So that individual names are protected, so that nobody knows who are the people who could have copied. And as I promised, since I respect the self-esteem of every individual, as all of you do, it is very, very important that even such admissions of mistakes should not be publicly known. So I am promising once again that these will be known only to me and to a handful of my colleagues. I am promising that this correspondence and this survey result will never be made public, will never be shared by anyone else. This shall always remain with us. But with this, we shall be able to proceed further in the remaining part of the FDP to do something useful for us and for everyone else. There are four hand raises. I will take those observations and comments. So, Marathwada Institute of Technology, over to you.
There are some submissions where the blank formats are submitted as it is. The structures given by the IIT Bombay, they are submitted as it is, downloaded and again submitted as the work. And there are some null values given as some text is to be given, so 1, 2 something is uploaded. We have made the assessment that this is not correct, this is not to be done, see again it. But whether that has been taken care in the final assessment or not?
I do not know how the local assessment is being done. I will have to check up with Jayakrishnan, Professor Sridhar Iyer and Sahana's team to find out what they have done. However, there are two aspects I would suggest. One is of course the assessment and the marks that are allotted to people. The second and more important thing is all our colleagues who have made such submissions have obviously made mistakes. So they have to be told that what should be the right response or what mistake should be avoided. I will have to talk to my colleague professors to find out how they are conducting the assessment. But very obviously, if I have resubmitted something which was given to me as a format, then obviously that is not a proper assignment. I deserve to get 0 marks. Or if I have not submitted correct values and I have some null values, I should not get proper marks in that assessment. I don't know how they are handling it, but thank you for pointing this out. We'll take care of this situation. Any other observation, please?
Sir, we are doing it parallelly in Moodle, and one more thing will be the wiki. So we are facing some problem how we have to upload in wiki in our submission. Can you give some ideas in wiki how, and also with the grading activities will be considered only that Moodle and IIT Bombay, that site only considered for the grading activities.
That
but wiki also you are told the parallelly we are submitting some document in wiki. How either this will be considered for grading activity for the only the timing we are doing. Can you give some ideas?
To the best of my knowledge, the grading is to be done on the submissions made on Moodle and submissions made on IIT Bombay. That is to the best of my knowledge. Wiki submissions are encouraged. We also encourage our students to submit on wiki, because wiki maintains a comprehensive record of all the related things which are put together. You will notice that the wiki submissions will permit comprehensive single collection of all related submissions. If you read the grading policy clearly states that in the course portfolio wiki, the submission that you have given is also assessed, and there are 2 marks portion assigned to that. So you will notice that the lab session submission has 2 marks and course portfolio wiki submission has 2 marks. This pertains to the first 4 weeks that were conducted by Professor Sarnamurthy, Professor Sridhar Iyer and Jayakrishnan. However, the second component, which is now ongoing, does not have any proportion to wiki. I hope that is clear.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. Let us go to another institution. BMS College of Engineering.
This is regarding the plagiarism, especially in MCQ, multi-choice questions. We have 2 approaches generally. One is what you have so have deliberated on, ethical approach. Why can't we adopt along with this a technological approach? Like instead of only 5 questions, I mean 5 same questions to all of us, 5 different questions. We can create a question bank and randomly a program that can generate different questions to different. This will be probably a sort of preventive method rather than a curative.
Thank you very much for this suggestion. To inform you, there are some courses which we run where we do such randomization, which is possible on the IIT Bombay X platform. For example, a programming course which I run, we get about 10,000 variations of every quiz question that goes out. So even if there are 10,000 students attempting the quiz, nobody gets the same quiz. It is not merely the permutation of the choices, but in the programming question, for example, if I ask people to analyze a program and ask them what would be the output of this program if input is m is equal to 2, n is equal to 4. Our randomization script actually permits us to generate questions with different values of m and n, and it generates proper set of answers with those values. Not only that, if I am a student and if I get one quiz today and I answer that quiz, obviously the specific quiz will be different from any other quiz. And tomorrow, if I complain that look, this is what I had answered, I have a record on IIT Bombay X platform on what exact quiz was given to me, so that there is no dispute. Such technological features are available. Unfortunately, for this particular FDP, in the quizzes that we have conducted so far, we were not able to implement such coding or scripting for randomization. However, to demonstrate your point, and I am very thankful that you raised this point, let me use this opportunity to tell everyone else that the colleague from BMS College is raising actually a very important point, because later on, when we use this technology for our students, and if 100 students are sitting in the lab, there could be obviously copying from neighbors in the quiz answers, because these are online quizzes. I am actually teaching a CS101 course for the summer batch in IIT Bombay right now. I have 85 students who all sit in the lab next to each other. But believe me, everybody gets an online quiz with a different question. Every set of 5 questions is different for everyone. So there is absolutely no chance of copying. In fact, in the first lab, my students tried to look here and there in the neighbors, and when they discovered that this idiotic professor has done some fancy stuff and everybody is getting a different question, they stopped looking here and there and started answering the question. So once again, sorry for the elaborate explanation, but I am grateful that you raised this issue. To demonstrate that this can be done on IIT Bombay X, in the week when I will discuss the features of MOOC's platform, to demonstrate this, I will actually create a quiz, discuss how such randomization is done in this particular platform, and encourage all of us to use such randomization in future. Thank you once again.
So thank you. There is two more supplements.
Please.
Further add on to the idiosity what you are already very novelly suggested, why can't our lab sessions, in our lab sessions, we can create some questions and send it, which can become a question bank?
Yes. Very well said. In fact, one of the motivations that I had while designing the last portion of the FDP, namely creation and nurturing of collaborative communities, and also the final submission specification, which is a team effort for creating an OER. I do have in mind that the open educational resource that would be created by many teams would actually be a set of such quiz questions pertaining to a specific domain or subdomain.
Yeah, the last supplement.
Yes.
Coming back to our ethical approach, I kindly request to encourage those who are doing sincerely and who really have got some difficulties either in time or especially the technical slag. You can kindly consider extending the resubmission, especially those who have demanded well in time. So many of us, we could not load. Upload our assignments in time, but we missed very marginally. The technology can clearly say who has missed, who hasn't missed. This will encourage those who are doing sincerely to do give some consideration and to give them a second chance. Need not be for everybody.
Yeah.
A technology can be well utilized to see who deserves and who doesn't.
Yeah. Very good and important point that you have made. I have not made any announcement in this regard. So our rules as of now remain firm that if you miss a deadline, then your submission will not be assessed. I will talk to my colleagues whether the submission dates could be defined such that there is a deadline for submission and assessment, but if I miss the deadline, I am still permitted to submit. Whether it is considered for marking or not is a different matter, but I have a record of all such submissions. And as you said, technologically I can assess who are the people who submitted within 5 minutes, half an hour, 1 hour or 1 day of that, and not 10 days later, and give appropriate credit. This credit cannot be given in terms of marks because we have already announced our grading scheme, but I'll tell you what I propose to discuss with my own colleague. We had decided that people must get minimum 50% score in all quantitative assessment. What I will do is, and that is what we do in our relative grading to our students also, that if we find a number of faculty members scoring close to 50% but not crossing that 50% barrier, then in all such cases, we will examine when they have submitted, and if they have submitted just missing the deadline, then we will consider that and lower what we call the passing percentage, so that serious minded people who are sincerely trying to do something do not suffer and they will get qualified.
We agree with this point, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Purnima College, Jaipur, over to you.
I've got a question related to undergraduate BTech program and postgraduate MTech program. In BTech program, we have got the assignment as well as the laboratories work. In that, most of the undergraduate students, they generally copy. Now, how to stop that? First question is that. And if we talk about the MTech thesis and other part, even the seminar and the project report, there also how much level of plagiarism is permitted? Because even if we check by iAuthenticate or Turnitin, which are the paid software, there some limitation is there. Beyond that limitation, we cannot omit it.
Yes.
So kindly suggest us, sir.
I had made one suggestion to AICT, which I will repeat for all our colleague participants to seriously consider. We have found the best bet is that all MTech dissertations and all BTech project reports must be compulsorily put on the institute website. They must be publicly available. Please remember that half the problems that happen in any society is because of non-transparency. If I submit an MTech thesis and let's say I have copied your thesis and submitted one as mine, as long as it remains only within a few examiners who are unable to find that copying, I'll get my MTech and merrily pass away. But if I am required to publish that MTech thesis and make it visible publicly, then I may be worried. Because if not today, tomorrow, somebody else may suddenly say, "Aray, a Lallu Phatak has copied from such and such person and this MTech should be revoked." That would act as a deterrent. That is the reason why I mentioned even in my presentation that a digital record is permanent and is non-refutable. A paper record, you can do a lot of hanky-panky and you may not be able to process it. So, my serious suggestion to all our colleagues, to their college administrations, please make it obligatory that every BTech report, every MCA report, every MTech report is publicly available. It is available in IIT Bombay. Of course, it is available as abstract, but sometimes with the complete dissertation. There is only one or two situations where the entire thing may not be published. And I will tell you those situations which are exempted even in IIT Bombay. Number one, if it is a sponsored project where somebody has funded the project and the intellectual property right is shared with that sponsoring organization, then those portions of the MTech thesis which relate to the protected intellectual property right are not required to be publicized. Yet, the remaining part is required to be publicized. But let me hasten to tell you that such MTech dissertations are hardly 10% of the total MTech dissertation. And at the BE level or MCA level, there are hardly any such sponsored project. Therefore, there is no excuse for anyone to say, my project is mine, I will not publish it. A project which has been assessed as a university submission is a public property and must be publicly known. So, my sincere suggestion is, in fact, when I will discuss the OER repository, I will discuss DSpace and I will tell you how this can be very easily established. The open source software available to build that repository, and all that you need to do is, my dear BTech student, my dear MCA student, my dear MTech student, you have submitted your thesis, but unless you upload it on this site under certification that this is my MTech thesis, you will not get your degree. Simple. And make that visible to everyone.
Thank you very much, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Let me go to this Sarvajanik College of Engineering. Over to you.
Sir, I am personally very much thankful for promoting the academic values that are very much essentially required with the ongoing mass activity of education in the higher level. Sir, my query is regarding the Turnitin platform that our university has been assigning to, or rather make it compulsory for all the ME thesis whoever are to be submitted to the university. It is made compulsory to be checked through the Turnitin website. Sir, my question is that we practice in a way that each of the student is allotted one slot on the website, and in this slot the student is advised to check again and again by changing or updating the same thesis and bring it down to the level of copied content as permitted by the university. Now, sir, if this document, so far it is a thesis document, it is okay. But if the student wishes to change the entire file to check some other report, then still the report is not published. But will the Turnitin refer to a document which is checked by some other student within the Turnitin platform, or it will consider only the publicly disclosed on the web available material only?
This is a good question. Unfortunately, I do not know the correct answer. But you are very right. If the Turnitin is an intelligent platform, it should take every submitted report for checking also as an addition to the corpus. But I do not know whether the Turnitin platform does it today or not. Most probably it relies only on the published material. But I'll have to check it with my colleagues and I'll get back to you. Most probably, I request you to post this question on discussion forum, and I or somebody else will respond to it. But thank you for raising this point.
From the previous face-to-face discussions that we had, can we continue the question with that, sir?
Yeah, sure.
Sir, it was suggested by the faculty that those students who are attending the flipped classroom activities, basically which are out of class activities and then coming up in the class for the in-class activity, certain incentives can be announced for the students. So, sir, what kind of incentives could be announced except for the marks?
There are two types of incentives which work best, not only with students but even with us grown-ups. One incentive is, of course, mark or grade, which you correctly point out that cannot be provided. The other incentive is a financial incentive. So, for example, we can declare an award. Now, where do you give this award from? So, you may say that you will collect, let's say, 100 rupees from every student in the class, and that becomes your kitty. And out of that collection, you will reward someone who does an extraordinary job. The second and less expensive mechanism of doing it is public acknowledgement and shabaski. That means if there are a few students who do an extraordinary job, publicize their names, not only to the class, but to the entire academic community of your department and of your institution. Believe me, most of us are encouraged by public acknowledgement of some good work that we have done. We have benefited tremendously by adopting this approach amongst our students' community in IIT. I see no reason why it will not work with your community. In fact, there is one additional suggestion that I would make in terms of conducting flipped classroom more easily in institutions which largely run undergraduate programs and therefore they do not have teaching assistants in the form of MTech students, ME students or PhD students. IIT systems benefit from the presence of a large number of postgraduate students. Now let me tell you this notion that teaching assistants must be either postgraduates or PhD students is not entirely correct. While we should have such people, but in colleges where such senior students or researchers are not available, it should be perfectly all right to try another mechanism of getting teaching assistants, and that is from our own undergraduate community. And let me tell you, this is not hypothetical. In IIT Bombay, in addition to MTech and PhD students, we ordinarily deploy third year or fourth year BTech students as teaching assistants for our core courses. They are selected on the basis of applications they want to apply for being TAs, and they participate in conducting labs and they participate in conducting flipped classroom session. In fact, the summer course that I am teaching, CS101, I have 4 TAs from amongst the applicants who are all BTech students, BTech second year, third year or fourth year students, and who work with me to help me conduct these flipped classroom sessions far more effectively. Because as you can guess, it's a people intensive task. I have to engage with my students in discussions and I cannot do it alone. Now this has not been tried by most of our colleges, namely trying to involve third year and fourth year BTech students as undergraduate TAs for my core courses. I would strongly suggest that this be encouraged because this has given great positive results. There have been situations in IIT Bombay where some of the better TAs are not my MTech or PhD students, but are the third year, fourth year undergraduate students, because some of the first yearites relate to them very easily. Of course, this cannot be done for all the undergraduate courses, particularly when I am teaching a third year course, then at most I can take a fourth year undergraduate as a TA. In IIT Bombay, there is an approved procedure of paying a TA-ship to such student for the entire semester. The amount is not very large, but that amount works as an additional incentive for senior BTech students to participate. Of course, there is an extra work that I have to do as a teacher. For example, at the beginning of the semester, I have to conduct a training session for these TAs, informing them what is flipped classroom and how to run it. And then for every week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks of portion, I have to actually discuss with my students what are the problems that I am going to consider in my flipped classroom and what kind of questions students may ask. But on the whole, it has been an extremely pleasant and useful experience.
Right, sir. So I take it as the student must be encouraged. So yes, we need to find a particular matter to encourage them to get into the circle.
Yes, that is what I feel.
Thank you.
Thank you. NMIMS Shirpur Dhulia, over to you.
Sir, in our peer assessment, we have been given a column of feedback at the end where we can show that if the people have not worked or given their screencast and has outsourced the video. So in that case, sir, we would like to know, can this be taken by the organizers to find out the plagiarism?
I suppose it can be done. However, as far as plagiarism for the FDP is concerned, we would limit this activity strictly at the moment to self-declaration and self-confession, and anything else that we would like to do, we would do it only at our end. I would not like individual remote centers or individual workshop coordinators to try and dig deeper into this. Please remember what I said. The self-esteem of every colleague teacher is as important to me as that of my own. And we would not like any activity or any public discussion on the matter of how such plagiarism could be detected. So I value your suggestion. What I would request is that not only you, but any other colleagues across the country who have such suggestions, please write an individual email to me directly. Don't write this in discussion forum, but write such emails directly to me. I will take cognizance of all these emails and will perhaps prepare a consolidated paper on how to deal with such future plagiarism. But your suggestion is important. I take the point.
Okay, thank you, sir. Beside this, I would like to keep my opinion that though we have several techniques like randomization or by putting up on Turnitin or a soap case, but it's finally to our integrity that we need to watch upon us that what we are preaching, we should also practice.
You are 100% right. There is no mechanism better than the self-check and self-control. That is the reason why everywhere in the world, confession is considered an extremely powerful cleansing mechanism for self. I may be tempted to make a mistake, but probably nobody else will ever be able to catch it. Only when I confess first to myself and second to someone in confidence, saying, sorry, I made that mistake, I'll not do it. That is the correct implementation of the value system. Anything else will not work generically in all cases. I agree with you. And that is what I meant when I said, collectively, we need to enhance the value system that prevails amongst us. And if we succeed in doing that, I am sure we will enhance the value system among the students as well. But it's a long uphill task and we have to perpetually keep doing it. Is there any more questions?
Hello, good afternoon, sir. I want to ask you one thing, that we are regularly using Turnitin for checking the assignment and research paper which we are submitting on the website like elsewhere. But there we face one problem. That say for example, I have previously submitted my research paper and my name, institute name also shown in the plagiarized, and the percentage goes around 20 to 25%. So can we deal such type of problem while giving the document for Turnitin?
Yes and no. You can simply remove the name of the author and the name of the institution or affiliation and submit that. However, let me tell you that the percentage that Turnitin gives needs to be taken with a pinch of salt. Ordinarily, unless the commonality is reported to be more than 60%, I would not bother too much. So anything between 30% to 60%, I would tell my student that, look, there is some problem here. Please go back and cross-check yourself. But anything which is 15% or 20%, of course, you have to be very careful what this percentage is. For example, if the 20% is reported, but the entire 20% belongs to two or three complete paragraphs outlining the major research finding which has been copied by someone else, then I should be badged on the head. However, if it is because of such similarities as you mentioned, it's okay. In general then, you have to take the output of the Turnitin in a very in a slightly subjective manner. You cannot take it just as a quantitative judgment. Let us admit, there is no foolproof mechanism of catching copying. After all, are we able to catch all copying done by our students in examination? So it is no different when it comes to research. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's go to the next institution.
Thanks for conducting such a great faculty development program, so that most of the teaching fraternity can get benefited. Now, sir, my question is related to the plagiarism. Suppose I want to write an article or a research paper, and I copy, I take a few lines or a paragraph from somewhere else, and I cite that paragraph. Now, is it considered as plagiarized material? So I have taken a reference or I have cited that paragraph or the content.
So let me explain the view of the academic community. If you take a paragraph exactly as is, although you cite the reference, you must put the entire paragraph in double quotes. That means that will indicate that you have taken the entire paragraph as is without modifying it. And then you cite. then that is not considered plagiarism, but that is also not considered very good writing practice. So, if I have submitted a paper which has such 3 or 4 paragraphs copied entirely from some other place, and I have cited that this paragraph is from this reference, this paragraph is from this reference, I will not be accused of plagiarism. But the reviewer will probably throw away that paper, saying that Fatak does not seem to have applied his mind, and he has not put the research finding of these 4 papers in his own words, which is what is expected in a good research paper. So, I hope I am very clear. No plagiarism, but no value add in the research paper that I submit. In general, I must learn to put even the cited thoughts of others in my own words, in my own perspective. That is what is expected when I submit a research paper.
Yes, sir. Just like I can take an example of software engineering. The definition of software engineering states, in software engineering, software is a collection of programs according to the IEEE.
Yes.
Software is assumed to be a collection of programs, procedures and their documentation.
Right.
So in most of the books,
yes,
this definition is very much common.
Correct. Incidentally, in your research papers, you are not only permitted to quote such definitions verbatim, but you are encouraged to do so, because this is not about a research finding. This is just the definition of a terminology which you must quote verbatim, otherwise it will lose its value. That is most certainly not plagiarism.
Sir, what is the acceptable limit of plagiarism?
Zero, zero.
Zero.
Yeah, absolutely. There is zero tolerance. Let me tell you, at least in IIT Bombay, the prevailing opinion is plagiarism is one of the worst academic crimes that can be committed by anyone. So, if it is a worst crime, it means it is like what you call murder. And if I murder someone, what is the punishment I get? I am latkaud in Fasi, period. There is absolutely no justification of any plagiarism. Now, of course, I am not committing a murder of another living entity. I am murdering somebody else's intellectual property right without acknowledging. So, what is the suitable punishment to me? I should be ostracized. The academic community should laugh at me, should put me to shame. If you know, there have been even vice chancellors who have been forced to resign from their position, not necessarily because they made a mistake, but a student of theirs wrote a joint paper in which material was plagiarized. So, even if I am one of the 4 authors, and if the paper contains plagiarism, I get as much blame as anybody else. And if I am holding an academic position, the correct penalty is to force me to come down from that position immediately. More importantly, I should become a laughing stock amongst all my colleagues. I should be ashamed. I should then apologize, say I will never do it in future, and move forward. There is no doubt in my mind that there is no question of defining percentage tolerance. 60% copy kiya to theek hai, 30% copy kiya to theek hai. This is all nonsense. Plagiarism is an academic crime of the greatest proportion. I will also share with you how I hold it to what another senior colleague of mine had mentioned. You might have heard about Mr. N. Vittal. I hope you know about Mr. Vittal. He was our CVC, Chief Vigilance Officer. And he was responsible for framing many of the government financial rules. He's a great person who tried to eliminate corruption from India. So, when I was discussing with him, telling him that why you have made the procurement rules so complicated that for IT procurement, many companies, I used to advise banks and financial institutions, and they were finding it very difficult to implement the procurement rules that government had circulated. And I said, why you have done that? You know what he told me? He says, Fatak, you come from the city of Bombay, which has the great degree of professionalism. But you come to Delhi and you go to many other places, the corruption is spreading like cancer. and we must take surgical action against it. Let me tell you, plagiarism is nothing but academic corruption, and we must prevent its spread surgically wherever required. Let us have no doubt about it. That is how we have to proceed.
Next question, sir.
Oh, one more question, okay. Go ahead.
A person from the RVS campus.
Yes.
I am from the Faculty of Agriculture, RVS College. Sir, lot of students, PG students, involved in the research. But the problem is, the most of the students come from the rural area. And even the there is not this type of online material available in the different colleges, at college level.
Yes.
So, my question is, what type of step would you like to suggest to make the student innovative in the field of agriculture education, sir?
It's an important question, but sadly it's a very generic question. What you are effectively asking is, how do I improve the entire education and research system in India, where large number of people do not have access to online material? Now, this is a generic question which is beyond the scope of this FDP, beyond your scope and my scope. Please raise this in the discussion forum, and we'll be glad to have a generic debate on this. But personally, I don't believe that there is any miracle solution that will solve the problem. All of us will have to work upon it. I have a lot of opinions and suggestions on this, but I don't think this is the place to discuss that generic problem. I appreciate your question, but we will defer the answer and discussion on this question to some other opportunity. If there are any more questions, please raise them either in the discussion forum or send email to us. Thank you so much. Over and out.